Amazon Games' New World is a game that feels epic everywhere you look. From the lush, verdant forests of Windsward to the desolate crimson wastes of Shattered Mountain, every inch of the land of Aeternum feels alive and brimming with possibility. But a world cannot exist in a vacuum. To truly make a game sing, you need to fill it with sound. Every strike of an axe against a tree, every scrape of sword against steel, every roar from a terrifying beast. It all helps to create a believable world that you can lose yourself in. And it all needs to work with a soundtrack underpinning the entire experience, immediately telling you what kind of world you're arriving in before you've even set foot on dry land. New World's audio director Jean-Edouard Miclot knew that Aeternum needed to have a soundtrack that could be both grand and intimate. It needed to feel epic, but also believable. For inspiration, the team looked to one of the most successful fantasy franchises of all time, Game of Thrones. With this show, Ramin Djawadi created some of the most iconic and evocative themes in television history. Naturally, he would be the perfect fit to bring the sounds of Aeternum to life. Ramin teamed up with Brandon Campbell, who he had worked with on Game of Thrones and Westworld, to start figuring out the sound of the game.
So we started the conversation with them long before we had a game. Everything changed when Ramin and Brandon joined the team. Something really big was starting to happen.
Patrick Gilmore actually reached out and just pitched a game to us, actually. He said, look, there's this game, it's a huge world, and he just kind of started describing it to us and immediately caught our attention, and we said, oh my God, this sounds amazing. The thing we thought was very exciting about this game was that it was a blank slate. We really had to start from scratch. That's also a challenge, obviously, at the same time, but that's what's exciting about it.
Getting something off the ground for the first time is also kind of frightening and challenging at times.
Ramin and Brandon were brought on board at an early stage of the project, and as such, they were presented with something of a blank slate to work with. While creating a soundscape for a world that hasn't yet taken shape was a daunting task, the pair approached it with cautious excitement.
The beginning is definitely the slowest part, right? You start from scratch, you try to figure out your tone, your instruments, your melodies.
The first step is writing themes and figuring out like instrumentation and everything in terms of process, and then we'd experiment more. Maybe we record some solo instruments on our own in here, or maybe we'd bring in some soloists to really kind of figure out what the sound of the game is. And as music is then being implemented and being put into the game, we then go and record the live orchestra, and then that gets replaced in the game with what our original demos were. The nice thing about composing for a game is that it's so drawn out, and even in the beginning we didn't have a lot of visual references, so we just kind of got to experiment and come up with melodies and thematic material and different soundscapes. For a game like New World, we were never writing to pictures, so we just got to write like, you know, 2, 3, 4, 5 minute pieces of music without worrying about hitting specific sync points. So it gives you a lot of freedom musically. You know, you have to stay within a certain emotion or vibe or something, but it gives you a lot of freedom to just write nice pieces of music. And because there's so much more music and the world's so much more vast and players play, you know, a feature film's 2 hours, you know, gameplay's gonna be thousands of hours for this. You use a lot more instruments and there'll still be a lot more cohesion because there's so much more music.
Games like New World aren't built in a day. And in these early stages, the composers had very little to guide them on their path to creating an appropriate score. To help spark their imagination, Amazon Games provided the duo with early concept art and designs for inspiration.
At first, there was not much, which actually was kind of fun. I mean, it's that thing where you start with so little and then it's like, how do you try to narrow it down? So, and then we were asking for like, give us anything that you have at this point. So it literally started with just sometimes the costumes or just some landscape design. I get very influenced by colors, so I get very inspired.
As the game progressed, we get some playthroughs and we'd see characters running through different areas and levels or are fighting one another.
We weren't trying to pinpoint an authentic time period or anything because it's just a different world, right? So it gave us the creative freedom to just get to react to what we were seeing and just attach a sonic landscape to it.
For a world as vast and diverse as Aeternum, the sounds and instruments used had to be equally varied to help ground the player in a sense of place befitting of the many regions of the game's world. But variety was an aspect of scoring that Ramin and Brandon embraced.
We used a lot. I mean, we used a lot. I mean, obviously, we used the orchestra quite a bit, and we used like traditional choir quite a bit, but we used solo singers, and we used solo instruments, mandolin to fiddle to accordion to ethnic woodwinds to anything we could think of. And, you know, we were trying to just really get wide, and then we used a whole bunch of different types of percussion. And
it was a dream job in a way for a composer because we could just look for any instrument and thought, oh, what, we haven't used this instrument yet.
Steel drums. I mean, we used steel drums. I mean,
could this possibly work? And we're like, it does work. It's, you know, let's put it in. And so we just nerded out and we just had fun with it.
Yeah, the one that's used most often in the game was that big drum that I found in New Mexico. Well, the biggest thing about it was just big. We like, you know, we kind of like big, deep drums, but it's beautiful. I mean, someone, you know, I don't know how long these take to make, but it's a beautiful piece of craftsmanship. They take out a big, big tree, they cut and they hollow out, and then they stretch over animal skin over both sides of it. It's got a beautiful tone, and I loved watching some of the musicians in Taos play it, and I just thought it was just a beautiful sound that would get a lot of mileage out in the game. We used quite a bit of synthesizers on the game as well. We use synthesizer besides from an arrangement standpoint also because you can create kind of sounds that acoustic instruments can't play without kind of some type of manipulation. So you play something that you listen to and you're like, I'm not exactly sure what that is. It kind of sounds maybe like a flute, but it's also not a flute. And so you can kind of create little otherworldly sounds with synthesizers, which is great for something like New World because it's rooted in, you know, in the real world, but it's a fictional land. So we tried to have some kind of like, you know, otherworldly sounds in there.
Yeah, and I think just as we were looking for as many different instruments as possible to have just a versatile score, we felt that synthesizers are just as much part of the palette that we're allowed to use because they're another great addition to add more color to these tracks.
You can hear these more electronic sounds from the synthesizers used to evoke fear in They Watch. Or hint at the cosmic forces in Miracle of Azoth. In contrast, acoustic sounds were used to inspire feelings of community or hope, which brings us to the game's main theme, simply titled Aeternum.
That was one of the first tracks we worked on, right? That was the one where we tried to identify and capture the overall mood of the game.
Definitely reference it even in other tracks that are playing a different type of theme or something. It was kind of like our anchor to, you know, because we said instrumentation and color-wise and dynamic-wise, we kind of end up kind of all over the place. And so we were always able to anchor it back to our game by referencing, like, you know, little motifs from the main theme.
Yeah, and I think because there is so many different tracks, it is kind of nice to think of it as this one theme that is kind of the core of it all. Like,
In their experimentation, the pair devised several unique sounds to represent the various factions and enemy types in the game. For the Angry Earth, they combined pounding drums with eerie choir vocals, creating an ominous but otherworldly feel. For the Corrupted, they used staccato strings to create a sense of dread. While the Lost's themes incorporated synthesizer sounds to instill a feeling of discomfort. The Ancients, being the precursors to all of the various enemy types, used a mixture of all these disparate elements. But it wasn't just the music that gave the enemies authenticity. The sound team devised entire languages for the creatures of Aeternum to use.
Regarding voices, we now have VO localized innate languages, but we also created three unique languages for the Corrupted, the Ancients, and the Lost. Each language has 4,000 words with present, past, and future tenses, and complete grammar and conjugation. So I could say, for example, in the Corrupted language, Mahiveb, Kin Bipanugo, Tetak Num, Mabmafibi, Kobambiwunge, Dempapokkaya. And that would mean, I see where they live. Come with me if you want to eat fresh meat.
Beyond the score, it takes hundreds, if not thousands, of ambient sounds to create a world that feels alive. From the rustling of tree branches in the wind to the sound of a spear striking a shield, a huge library of sound effects was required to give Aeternum the level of detail it deserved.
I come from a small village in the northeast of France called Saint-Nabor, and during my mini trips to visit family, my dad would come with me to help me record the sounds in the forest just 5 minutes drive from their house, and would take ropes, would wrap them around the trees and pull them slowly to get a long cracking sound. Hearing those sounds in the live game reminds me of those intimate father and son moments. I'm pretty happy with how the musket turned out after recording the Civil War reenactment in Huntington Beach. We had authorization to place all our microphones on the field and around the cannons and close and far away from the muskets. You see, I feel that commercial sound libraries tend to focus too much on the blockbuster experience, and we're more looking for documentary-style recording, so we knew we had to record it ourselves. And the musket shot right now is pretty complex. It changes over distance with the direction, but it also has different reflections for the different biomes and different indoor locations too. For the sound effects, I think it comes from the level of details. Your voice gets muffled and resonates if you put a helmet on. You can also hear the rustle of your shirt or your leather coat all the way to the tinkle of your metallic armor. And we also added sounds for the sword on your hip, or the bow that you have equipped on your back, all the way to the shield that you carry. You see, we wanted the player to feel the weight of every weapon. But there's a catch. The heavier you get, the louder you become too. For the ambiences, if you go under the rain, you will hear the drops falling on your leather coat. But it will sound like tinkles if you wear metallic armor. That rain actually changes if you're on the road or if you're on the grass. And if you go inside a wooden house, and it will change also if you're inside a tent. Yes, you'll actually hear the drops falling on the fabric above your head. The ambience is actually driven by the assets, so if you are in a forest and some players chop down all the trees, the sound of the wind in the pine trees will actually gradually fade out to complete silence.
Through music, languages, and sound effects, The sound team has designed a world that feels real and tangible, no matter what activities the player is participating in. This is thanks not only to the almost boundless creativity of the talent involved, but their enduring spirit of collaboration.
This was the first, even though not release date-wise, but starting date-wise, it's the first time I got to collaborate with Ramin as a co-composer. And so dynamically, our relationship was just a little bit different than it had been previously. And getting to work on melodies and themes and music with him was really kind of a special experience for me. And, you know, I'm really proud of the music we came up with for this game. It will always have like a very kind of special place in my heart.
We also recorded the Prague Orchestra a few times because we can't fake live performance. Musicians add their own layers of interpretation, and it just makes everything more real and organic. Collaborating with them was a dream come true for me, but now might be the best time for you to judge it by yourself. Go listen to the soundtrack or come join us in the game and tell us what you think. See you in Aeternum.